Before I start, what I want to do is actually just say thank you to you guys who are here tonight, and also those who have probably hopefully tuned in with the live stream. And the reason I say that is because as scientists, we're not actually allowed out very often, especially not to meet members of the public. So it's quite an honour actually to meet people like yourselves. You know, you're the people who dedicate not only your time but also your hard-earned Australian tax dollars, to funding a lot of the medical research that we do. And so actually, a lot of what we do couldn't happen without the generosity of you. So on behalf of myself, but also all the scientists in medical research, do say thank you. So moving on, we're here to talk about pancreatic cancer. Now, I'm sure many of you know that pancreatic cancer is a very terrible disease, and it's estimated to be the fourth leading cause of cancer-related deaths in the world. And it actually affects both men and women to the same degree. Why is it so bad? Well, one of the problems we have with pancreatic cancer is that we don't have any really good treatments and therapies available. And I'm just putting this up on the right-hand side there to give you an example of how the treatments are sort of slowly improving, but still have a long way to go. And what this shows, the graph is showing you, is the number of people left alive after a certain amount of time. So on the sort of y-axis, the top to bottom is the number of people, and across the bottom is time. So as we move along, we see this drops. And the average expectancy from diagnosis of pancreatic cancer is around about 6 to 8 months, depending on the treatment you're on. So this really, drives home the message that we need to not only understand pancreatic cancer better and why it spreads around the body, why it kills people, but also come up with new therapies and new ways of treating it. So what I want to do is talk to you about really sort of three things. One is, how are we studying pancreatic cancer cells, their behavior, and the way that they respond to drugs? How are we studying the environment that pancreatic cancer cells live in and grow? So cancer cells don't just exist on their own, they actually form part of a tumor. And what we can do with that knowledge in order to design and develop and test new drugs, or, as Marina will talk about, repurpose old drugs or other drugs approved for different cancers into the pancreatic cancer setting. So let's talk about some of the science. And I promise I will try and keep this as easy as possible to take away. The first thing I want to say is that when we, as scientists, want to study cancer cells, you can't see cancer cells. To do this, we need essentially high-end or powerful microscopes, such as the one shown in the picture. This is actually currently downstairs in the basement here at the Garvan Institute, and this is one of these pieces of equipment that allows us to visualize individual cells. Now, the Garvan is investing heavily into a lot of the technologies, the cutting-edge technologies that allow us as scientists to study the behavior of things like pancreatic cancer. However, there's a problem. If we take a cancer cell and you look at it under a microscope, you're not actually going to see much. And an example I've drawn here, this is meant to represent a cancer cell. It's about as much as you'll see under a microscope without any additional help. You might get the outline, you might see something. This is because cancer cells don't have a color, they don't give off something that we can automatically detect. However, we've borrowed a trick from our friend the jellyfish. Now, some of you might have been to an aquarium and you see these beautiful jellyfish and these greens and these blues and these reds floating around in their tanks. It's because they have protein inside them, a molecule, that under UV light gives off a color. This one here is called green fluorescent protein because it fluoresces green. And what we could do, or what scientists have done for many years, is to take this protein and put it into cells of interest. In our case, pancreatic cancer cells. And what this essentially allows us to do is, now with our microscopes, see the cancer cells and see what they're doing. What's also interesting is we can make them any color we want, pretty much. So we can make them green, blue, yellow, red. What's more important is that we can also now create cells that change color in response to something. So, for example, we could create a cell that might be blue when it's in normal situation, but changes to yellow when it's been exposed to a drug. Now, this is really going to be important in understanding how effective our therapies are in getting to cancer cells and whether or not they're having the intended effect. And to give you an example of this, I'll put up a couple of movies just at the bottom. It'll cycle back through again, but on the left-hand side, the first image under treatment one, you'll notice that this cell looks quite yellow in color. As we move across to the center image, we see that the color of the cell looks blue. Whereas on the right-hand side, it appears yellow again. And this is because this contains what we call a biosensor, one of these fluorescent proteins that changes color when we give drugs to the cancer cells. So the blue in the center is when the treatment is working. The yellow on the left and right is when the treatment is not working. So we can start using these tools to look at how cancer cells are responding to a particular drug. It tells us not only is the drug getting to the tumor, but whether it's having the intended effect or not. And so these are some of the tools that we use, and Marina will probably mention a couple more of these in her talk, that allow us to see the cancer cell, see what it's doing, ask the question of, are our drugs getting there, and are they being effective? And it takes that guesswork out of designing and testing new therapies. So I've told you that the cells are sort of the basic unit, if we like, of life. But what's important is to sort of understand as well how cells come together to form tissues, organs, and ultimately organisms, such as yourself. So if we think about your liver for a moment, or your lungs or your brain, it's made up of liver cells or lung cells or brain cells. But your blood is also made up of cells. And there's a fundamental difference between a liver and your blood. Your liver stays as a liver in one place, which is quite useful. Your blood will travel around the body. It flows around the body. It also flows over the floor if you happen to cut yourself. The difference between these two organs, or these two tissues we can call them, is something that's called the extracellular matrix. Now, we break that down very simply. Extracellular means outside of the cell. Matrix means a mesh, a web, a glue that holds things together. And so our cancer cell here on the left, currently expressing our GFP protein from the jellyfish, if we look at that in the context of its matrix, we can see that we have a lot of sort of fibers or strands that go around the outside of the cell. So we've got some purple fibers, we've got some green branchy things, there's a couple of little orange and pink blobs in there. These are all components of what we call the extracellular matrix, or the matrix. And there are hundreds of these building blocks, and they're assembled in different ways, they come together, and they provide essentially that framework, that mesh, that holds cells together. But why is it important? Well, just as you and I would respond to our surroundings, the environment around us, so cells and cancer cells also respond to their environment. What this does, this matrix, it gives cells bits of information, such as when to divide or reproduce, when to die, when to move or when to not move, and when and how and what molecules also to create and produce, many of which are also then built into their extracellular matrix. So the matrix is very important in controlling tissues and organs and the behavior of the cells within them, and it helps to keep them maintained and help them function properly. And to give you an example of the matrix and cells, we have our green fluorescent protein cells here on the right-hand side. And the purple strands that you can see running through that are matrix fibers. So this is one type of matrix component. Remember, there's hundreds, but we're just looking at one at the moment. And you'll see that the cells are crawling along the fibers, around the fibers, and those fibers are giving information to the cells about which direction to move. But if you look more closely, you'll actually see that some of the cells are moving the fibers. They are pushing them aside, squeezing between gaps. They're even starting to break some of them down. And this highlights a really important point, that whilst the cells are influenced by their microenvironment, they in turn can also influence their microenvironment. So it's sort of a loop, a feedback loop that goes round and round and round. And that's important because in cancer, and pancreatic cancer especially, this extracellular matrix is significantly altered. So what you've got is cancer cells in a very different microenvironment, but what they're also doing is changing that microenvironment. And it becomes this runaway effect Your microenvironment causes your cells to misbehave, if we can say that. This encourages them to remodel their environment, that reinforces the signals, and so on. At the same time, it also makes your cells less responsive to cancer drugs. So we've now got a bit of a problem. If we can't target the cancer cells because they're not listening or not responding, can we target the matrix, or target the matrix as well, in order to restore that balance? And that's a lot of the work that I'm interested in doing. So to give you sort of some examples of how we can combine this visualization of our cancer cells, the visualization of our matrix, and how we go on testing sort of the response of new drugs, I'm going to show you an image here. So this is some cells with, again, labeled in green within, I think you probably see the purple of that extracellular matrix. And you'll see that the cells are sort of crawling within that matrix. They're putting out these long projections and moving through it. And so this is no treatment. And these are models that we use to test drugs. If we now add a drug, we can look what happens to the cancer cells. So you see they've stopped moving now. This idea that they're not going to move around the body or metastasize to a secondary site. But also, if you can see the purple, that matrix around them also looks different again. So what we've done is we've started to break that sort of loop of matrix cells, matrix cells, matrix cells, which means that our drugs become more effective, and we can also essentially block the spread of these, or the migration of these cells around the body. Why is that important in a clinical setting? Well, whenever a cancer is diagnosed and confirmed by a pathologist, they take a biopsy, they take a very small piece of that tumor, and they have a look at it under a microscope, and they say, well, we can see the cancer cells, and we can tell you certain things about it because the cancer cells, we can recognize certain features. But I've just told you that the cells don't exist on their own, that they have a matrix around them. And so every biopsy also has the matrix with it. And so we're starting to ask those questions of, well, that's free information. That's information that we already have. Can we begin looking at that? Can we understand and find what would be a bad matrix versus a good matrix? And the example I've shown here is where we've looked at one matrix component. Again, this is shown in purple. And you can see that in some of the... So each one of these nine is a biopsy sample from a pancreatic tumor. Some of the three in the top have a very high amount of this purple, very, very high levels of matrix, whereas those in the bottom have very low. So this would tell us that, well, these tumors wouldn't respond to a drug that targeted the extracellular matrix, or maybe they're perhaps more sensitive to a chemotherapy agent, whereas the ones at the top should be perhaps treated a bit differently. Maybe we should use a matrix targeting therapy as well as a chemotherapy. And so we can start to stratify or subdivide patients based on the matrix as well, in order to fine-tune, essentially, and personalize patient medicine. So just to wrap up in the last minute or so, the improved understanding of cancer will underpin the development of all new therapies heading to the clinic. But this is only possible through the development of new technologies and platforms, how we can study these cancer cells, and also how they interact with that microenvironment. In cancer, I've shown you and hopefully convinced you that the matrix is incredibly important, and it's significantly altered in pancreatic cancer. And it essentially represents almost a sort of untapped resource of new potential therapeutic targets. And finally, to lead into the next couple of talks, the translation of the basic biology and the understanding that we achieve through this sort of study of the cancer can only be realized through the work of translational scientists and also clinicians. And you'll hear from Marina and Lorraine about some of their work very shortly. And so that I'd like to finish, and thank you for your attention.